Today we are discussing about the endocrine system. So what we will see in this endocrine system? In our body, so there are so many secretions will produce, which helps for maintenance of our body development. And so these secretions, they are released by some of the hormones. They are called endocrine hormones, and we will study about their anatomical structure, and then their blood supply, their position, and what are their clinical significance. The endocrine system, they are the ductless gland where they secretion passes directly from the blood. Okay, so what happens here? There are so many endocrine glands. So these endocrine glands, they are ductless glands, whereas the pancreas, so it is with the duct, so it is having a duct. Okay, the other secretions, so there are so many secretions which are produced in these endocrine glands. They directly secretes, or they secrete and passes directly to the blood. Okay, they release directly into the blood for the circulation. Next, so here the end, so again it's the same, it's made up of ductless glands. They secretes hormones directly into the bloodstream and regulates the body functions. These hormones, they are helpful for our body function, as well as sometime they also helps in the development of the body also. So what are these? So which are the endocrine glands present in our body? From top to bottom, so that is the pituitary gland and the hypothalamus. So these are the structures which are present in the brain, and then the pineal gland, hypothalamus, pituitary gland, parathyroid gland, and thyroid gland. So these parathyroid glands present behind the thyroid gland. Next, the thymus, the adrenal gland. Adrenal gland means, so they are the glands which are present above the kidneys. And then the testis and ovaries. So testis in the male side and the ovaries in the female. All these are the endocrine glands. And the pancreas is also an endocrine gland, which is having both mixed type of functions. So that is endocrine as well as exocrine functions. So these we'll study later. Next, first we'll discuss about the pituitary gland. So what is this pituitary gland? So it is the most important endocrine gland which is present in the brain. It's a very important endocrine gland which secretes and also at the same time it controls the many functions of the endocrine glands. It also secretes the hormones, and also it controls all the endocrine glands in the body. So that is why it is called the master gland. Okay, or you can say it's a boss. It is a boss, or it is a master of all the endocrine glands. So where it controls all the endocrine glands. So where it is present? It is present or located in the base of the skull. So that area is called hypophyseal fossa. Okay, or it is also called cella persica. Okay, then it is connected with hypothalamus by infundibulum. So this is what you are seeing here. This is the pituitary gland. Okay, 1 minute. This one here you see the infundibulum, this one, this part. So this is the infundibulum, and then the upper part is the hypothalamus, and this lower one, this one is the pituitary gland. So here the below you have a pituitary gland, above the red color structure is the hypothalamus, in between, so these two structures are connected by the structure called infundibulum. All these are the names for the structure, the connecting, and the roof, it is, or the pituitary gland is covered by structure or a layer of meninges that is called the diaphragm shelling. Okay, this pituitary gland consists of two parts. So when we draw the pituitary gland like this, it is divided into two parts. Okay, like this. So one is the anterior pituitary and the another one is the posterior pituitary. The anterior pituitary is also known as adenohypophysis, and the posterior pituitary is known as neurohypophysis. So in the anterior pituitary, most of the hormones, they are secreted, and the posterior pituitary is controlled by the nervous system. Okay, they releases the pituitary hormone, and this infundibulum, sometimes it is also called as pituitary stalk. It is also called infundibulum and it is also called pituitary stalk. And the arterial supply is by hypophyseal artery, that is superior and inferior hypophyseal arteries. So from where they are coming, these are the branches of internal carotid artery. The venous drainage is in the through the cavernous sinus and by intercavernous sinus. Next, this is the area. So you can see this is the area where the pituitary gland is present. It is present in the base of the skull, this area. So where I am putting this mark. So this is the area where you will see the pituitary gland in the skull. And this is the larger structure. So this one is the base of the skull. This area is called pituitary fossa or hypophyseal fossa. And then it is connected by, this is the stalk. So this one is the pituitary stalk. Okay. Now, what are the relations? The relations, if this is the pituitary gland, so first one is, this is the on each side, and this one, this is the inferiorly and above. So this part. So this part is the superior relation. Superiorly, you all know what it is. Superiorly or the roof. Roof is formed by diaphragm shelling. So anteriorly means in front of this gland. Posteriorly means behind the gland. So what are the relations? On each side, this is the whole, like the blue structure what you are seeing, that is the cavernous sinus. Okay, and then superiorly it is covered by diaphragm shelling, and inferiorly what we have, the inferiorly where the pituitary gland is present, that bone is called sphenoid bone. That is the body of sphenoid bone. And anteriorly, trabeculum, cellae, and it has the nasal cavity. So, in the front side. Next, posteriorly, behind, you have dorsum cellae. These are the structures relating to the pituitary gland. Now, as I told you, so in the pituitary gland, so there are secretion of hormones. So when there is a secretion, they have to be released from that particular part. So how they release or how they enter into the blood? So that system is called hypothalamic hypophyseal portal system. Hypothalamic hypophyseal portal system. It means it is coming from the hypothalamus, then hypophyseal. Hypophyseal means another name of pituitary gland and the portal system. This is the hypothalamus here. So what you are seeing? Hypothalamus, and this is the hypophyseal. So this is the pituitary gland. So in between this, so this system, the circulation, what it is called, hypothalamic hypophyseal system. What it contains? It includes or it contains the set of capillaries. So what are these capillaries? These capillaries are the smallest blood vessels. Okay. So these are the smallest blood vessels. So some of them, they are present in the hypothalamus and some they are present in the pituitary gland or hypophyseal cerebri also. So what happens? So there are some neurons which are present in between this, and then with the help of this, there is a release of hormone from the hypothalamus, then to the pituitary gland, and then they release into the blood. Okay, like this. So in detail of this system, you will study in the physiology. Only this much information is required in the anatomy. Okay, next. As we told, so there are two parts of pituitary gland. One is the anterior pituitary, another one is the posterior pituitary. Remember, what are the hormones released from the both part of the pituitary gland? So they are from the anterior pituitary. Just remember this. Diagram, it will be easy to remember, or you can also remember this also. So what are the hormones? So they are ACTH, adrenocorticotropic hormone, TSH, so that is thyroid stimulating hormone. What is GH? Growth hormone. So whenever you ask in the exams also, don't write any abbreviations, you have to write the details. Okay, in the exams you have to write abbreviations, don't write only GH or PRL, ACTH. Okay, you have to write full name. So that is adrenocorticotropic hormone, thyroid stimulating hormone, growth hormone, prolactin, okay, luteinizing hormone, follicular stimulating hormone. So this is the these luteinizing hormone, melanin stimulating hormone. So luteinizing hormone, it helpful for the release of hormones in the females. Okay, next, the hormones which are produced, which are secreted in the posterior pituitary, the one is oxytocin, another one is antidiuretic hormone. So what this oxytocin does? So this oxytocin acts on the uterus and also on the breast. How? On the uterus, the oxytocin helps in the expansion, enlarging the uterus during delivery. With the help of this oxytocin, the uterus is enlarged and helps for the delivery of the baby. Okay, and also this oxytocin helps the release of the milk, release of the breast milk for the baby. Okay. Next, antidiuretic hormones, also known as vasopressin. So this vasopressin, it secretes in the kidney and it maintains the water reabsorption. So it maintains the water reabsorption of the body. Okay, see in this diagram also you can see this is the hypothalamus and the pituitary gland. The system in between, so what it's called, this is the hypothalamo-hypophyseal portal system. So this is clear here about pituitary gland. It is clear now. Okay, next. Next is the thyroid gland. What is this thyroid gland? So where this thyroid gland is present? Anyone have answer? So where the thyroid gland is present? Any answer for this? The thyroid gland, it is the gland which is present in the front of the neck. Okay, just below the thyroid cartilage. So how it is? The thyroid gland is, I have drawn this line, how it looks like? It looks like a H-shaped structure. It looks like an H-shaped structure or also like a butterfly. Okay, and there are two lobes, the right lobe and the left lobe. So these both the lobes, they are connected by isthmus. So what is the structure? Lobes of the thyroid gland is connected by what structure? The lobes, they are connected by isthmus. Okay. Next. So it is the one of the large endocrine gland, and usually it is larger in females. Okay, and it also enlarges during menstruation and also during pregnancy. The length is 50 to 60 millimeters and the weight is 25 to 30 grams. As I told, it is H-shaped, or also it looks like a butterfly shape structure. The hormone secreted from the thyroid gland, it is called thyroxine or thyrocalcitonin. These are the two hormones secreted from the pituitary gland. The thyroxine, it is responsible for the different body activities. Whereas the thyrocalcitonin, it lowers, it decreases the blood calcium level. Okay. Next. What anatomical structures they are having? Like all any other glands. So we have seen the heart, lungs, all these structures, they are having some coverings. Same like here, the thyroid gland is also covered by layers. So that is called the true capsule and the false capsules. Okay. The vessels supplying the glands lies between the true capsule and the false capsule. So this is the capsule which covers the thyroid gland. From where it comes? This true capsule, it comes from the connective tissue. It is from the peripheral condensation of connective tissue. From there it comes and covers the blood vessels, also the thyroid gland. Next, the false capsule. So this false capsule, it lies outside the true capsule. So if I draw like this, so this is in between, you have a blood vessels like this. So this one, it is the, this is the true capsule and this is the false capsule. So from where it comes? It comes from the pretracheal layer of deep cervical fascia. It is coming from the pretracheal layer of deep cervical fascia. What is the function here? So it fixes the gland to the thyroid and cricoid cartilage. So what happens? This fascia, it fixes, it comes, this gives the attachment, or it fixes the thyroid gland to the thyroid cartilage and the cricoid cartilage. So where they are, these are the glands here. This is the thyroid cartilage, and then below you have a cricoid cartilage. This is the thyroid gland. Okay, so with the help of this false capsule, it attaches, it get fixed to the thyroid cartilage and the cricoid cartilage. So that is why the gland moves with the larynx during deglutition. Now what I will tell to all of you, keep your fingers in front of the neck and then swallow. Keep your fingers in front of the neck and then swallow. And what happens? So there is, you are feeling some movements in the, some structure. So the movement, what is the structure moving up and down? That is, the structure moving up and down is the larynx. The Adam's apple, oh yeah, Adam's apple is the thyroid cartilage. You got it? The Adam's apple, the person who told, so that structure, that is the structure, it is also called the thyroid cartilage. Then the other thing, other parts, the lobes of the thyroid gland. So there are two lobes, the right and the left lobes. So these lobes, they also have a part. So what are those parts? That is, one is the apex. This is the apex of the thyroid gland, and then this is the base of the thyroid gland. Okay, next is the isthmus. So what is this? This is the isthmus. It is the structure which connecting right and left lobe. So where this isthmus is present? It is present or opposite. It is opposite to the second, third and fourth tracheal rings. Okay. So this connecting the two lobes. It has two borders and two surfaces. That is, this one, if you draw a line like this, the upper one is the superior border, the lower one is the inferior border. And the anterior surface and the posterior surface. Next, the pyramidal lobe. So, where is this pyramidal lobe? The structure which is present here. So, this one is the pyramidal lobe. So, it is the developmental anomaly. If it is there also, no problem. If it is not there also, no problem. So, it is just a small abnormality. It is present. So, for this, nothing to worry. Okay. Next, what are the structures it is relating? The apex and base and other surfaces of the thyroid gland. So, it is related to what other structures? It is very, very important. Why? Because the thyroid gland, it is sometimes it enlarges, it compresses the other structures. So, that's why we have to know what are the relations of the thyroid gland. The apex, it reaches the oblique line of the thyroid cartilage. So, where this is the apex, till where it goes up to the oblique line of the thyroid cartilage. And then, where the base is present, the base of the thyroid gland, it lies opposite to the fifth tracheal ring. Okay. Next, the surfaces. The superior surface and the medial surface. The superior surface, it is covered by muscles like this. You can see in the below diagram. So, these are the muscles. Okay. Don't worry about the muscles. Okay. On the medial side, see here. On the medial side, in the upper part, it is related to the larynx and pharynx. In the upper part, the thyroid gland is related to the larynx and pharynx. And then, along with the external laryngeal nerve. There is an external laryngeal nerve. So, these three structures, it is related to larynx, pharynx and external laryngeal nerve. Okay. In the lower part, it is related to trachea and esophagus. And then, recurrent laryngeal nerve in between the trachea and esophagus. These structures are very, very important during thyroid gland operation. So, if any damage to these structures, so there will be a loss of voice, recurrent laryngeal nerve. So, it will cut the, if the nerve is cut, there will be a problem in the also. And the posterior surface, it is related to, on the posterior side, what it has? It has a parathyroid gland and inferior thyroid artery. Okay. So, there are, what are the structures in the posterior side? It has parathyroid gland, inferior thyroid artery, and also it has a carotid sheath. So, it is one of the, again, this is also one of the important structure here, this one. So, now all of you, yeah, three structures. So, what this carotid sheath contains? So, these are the three main structures. And then, this carotid sheath contains common carotid artery, the internal jugular vein and the vagus nerve. So, these are the three important structures which are present in the carotid sheath. Okay, don't get confused. So when if we ask, so what are the contents of the carotid sheath, you have to write common carotid artery, internal jugular vein and the vagus nerve. If you write parathyroid gland, inferior thyroid artery, your answer is wrong. Okay, now all of you keep your fingers on the side of just below your ear. So that is the area where you will feel, you will have this carotid artery. Okay, what are the blood supply to the thyroid gland? The blood supply is superior thyroid artery, inferior thyroid artery and thyroidema artery. The veins, the superior thyroid vein, middle thyroid vein and the inferior thyroid vein. And the another important structure, that is the lymphatic drainage of the thyroid gland. So it's divided into three parts: the upper part, lower part and the isthmus. The upper part of the thyroid gland, it drains into upper deep cervical lymph nodes. The lower part, it drains into lower deep cervical lymph nodes. Whereas the isthmus, it drains into brachiocephalic lymph nodes. Then, so what are the clinical features you will commonly find in the thyroid gland? The enlargement of the thyroid gland is known as the goiter. If there is the enlargement of the thyroid gland, then the goiter. Except during menstruation and lactation. That's what I told you. Except the normal. So normally the thyroid gland enlarges during menstruation and lactation. Lactation means pregnancy. So after the pregnancy, again thyroid gland will become normal. And then again after the menstruation, the thyroid gland will become normal shape. Other than this, if the thyroid gland is enlarged more than the normal, then it is called goiter. Okay. Next. This is about the enlargement of the gland. So in the beginning, we also told, so there are some secretions which are there in the thyroid gland. What happens if the secretion is more and what happens if the secretion is less? Here, thyroxine. So here it means T3 and T4. Don't get confused with the thoracic vertebra. So in relation to thyroid gland, in relation to thyroid gland, so T3 and T4 means thyroxine, the hormone thyroxine. So when there is hypothyroidism, so why hypothyroidism means there is decreased secretion of the thyroid hormones. Okay, so what happens here? So when there is a decreased secretion, it causes cretinism. It causes a condition called cretinism in children's and myxedema, and another condition in adults, it is called myxedema. When there is, remember, hypothyroidism, it is due to decreased thyroid hormones, that is T3 and T4. Okay. So when there is decreased hormone in the children, that condition is called cretinism, and in the adults it is called myxedema. Okay. Hyperthyroidism. So what is hyperthyroidism? Hyperthyroidism means excess, more than normal, excess secretion of thyroxine T3 and T4. Again, I repeat, in relation, so when we are discussing, if there is any questions comes, T3, T4 in the thyroid gland, don't confuse with the thoracic vertebra. Here it is thyroxine. Okay. Next, see the pictures here. So this is what I am telling, the abnormal enlargement of the thyroid gland. So that condition is called goiter. And then what happens when there is in the adults? In the adults, the eyes will be enlarged like this. It is called exophthalmosis. Exophthalmosis. It is enlarged eye. And the patient, when you see such patients, so it will be very scary. They look very scary. Okay. And then the cretinism. So what happens here? See the tongue of this baby. So the tongue will be enlarged, unable to close the mouth. These are some features. There are many other features. So just remember, if there is decreased secretion in the thyroid hormone in the children, it causes cretinism. In the adults, it's called, what is called in the adults? It's called pyxedema. Next, the parathyroid hormone. So where they are present? In the beginning we discussed. So these parathyroid glands, they are present in the posterior part. So where in the posterior part? So these are found along the posterior edge of the thyroid lobe. So where is the posterior edge here? So just see this line where I am drawing. This is the posterior edge of the thyroid gland. Can you make out here? Okay. So how many glands are there? So there are two pairs of glands. So it means there are total four parathyroid glands. Two superior and two inferior. So these are the two superior and two inferior parathyroid glands. Where the superior parathyroid glands are present? They are located at the middle of the posterior border of the thyroid lobe. So it is, they are present at the middle part of the posterior border of the thyroid lobe. Whereas the inferior parathyroid gland, they are close to the inferior pole of the thyroid gland, below the inferior thyroid artery. There is one artery coming, goes like this. One artery goes like this. That is the inferior thyroid artery. Below the inferior thyroid artery, you find inferior parathyroid glands. Okay. And the color, shape and width are yellowish, brown in color, oval in shape, and they are 50 milligrams in each. So it is, they are covered by the false capsule of the thyroid gland along the posterior surface. So these glands, they are present in the false capsule or embedded. Embedded means covered by false capsule. They are supplied by superior and inferior thyroid arteries. Same like the thyroid hormones, the hormone secreted from the thyroid gland, it is called thyroid hormone. Here also they secrete the hormones, they are called para hormones, parathormones, and they regulates the calcium level in the bone and the blood. So what is the function of the hormones of the parathyroid gland? It regulates the calcium level in the bones and the blood. Next, the suprarenal gland, or they are also called adrenal glands. Where they are present? So they are present above the kidney. So these glands, they are present above the kidney, and they are the endocrine glands. And they are, so when we take the section, when we cut, it looks like the outer part is yellow and the inner part is the brown color. The outer part, the outer yellowish part is called the cortex, and the inner brown part is called medulla. So where they are present? They are present in the epigastric region. In which region these are present? They are present or at the site of the epigastric region, opposite to T12 and lumbar first or second vertebra. The right adrenal gland lies more superior at the upper pole of the kidney and adjoining part of the medial border. It means the right suprarenal gland, see here, it lies more superior. It lies almost top of the right kidney. Here also, they also secrete some hormone. So what are the hormones? So these hormones, here they are different. So they are secreting some hormones, they are secreted from the cortex, and some hormones they are secreted from the medulla. From the cortex, it secretes mineralocorticoids, glucocorticoids, and sex hormones. They are secreted from cortex of the suprarenal gland. What happens? The hypersecretion of the glands, they causes Cushing syndrome. And the hyposecretion, they causes Addison's disease. Whereas in the medulla, they secretes epinephrine and norepinephrine. The hypersecretion of these called pheochromocytoma. The condition is called pheochromocytoma. Next, what are the differences you see in the suprarenal gland, the right and left? They are not similar structurally and the relation wise, they are not similar on the right and left part. Okay, the right one, so where position is same, position is, you can easily make out, right one is above the right kidney and the left one above the left kidney, along the medial border of the kidney. See here, this is what the difference. Right one is the upper pole of the kidney, whereas the left one lies along the medial border of left kidney. Medial border of left kidney. Okay. It is, right one is triangular in shape. You can make out here. See this. The right one is triangular in shape, and the left one is semicircular. Okay. And the right one, the hilum of the right suprarenal gland directed upwards and the left one directed downwards. The venous what happens? So anyway, the lecture is recording, no problem. So those who are not unable to hear, you can download the lecture and you can hear, no problem. And the venous drainage what is how long medial? I didn't get what is how long medial. The venous drainage, the right side it drains in the inferior vena cava and the left one oh, this one medial border. Okay. You want to see? I will show. See here. So if I draw, if you consider this is the body. Okay. So there is a line. This is called near to this. It is near, close to the midline. It is called medial. Close to the midline. It is called medial. So it is clear now. Okay. On the relations, the medially and laterally. Laterally, always remember, laterally means away from the midline. Medially means close to the midline. Okay. Medially, it is related to inferior vena cava, laterally to the right lobe of the liver. So this is the relation of the right kidney, the left kidney, the lesser sac and the stomach bed and the body of the pancreas and the splenic artery, they are in the below. The blood supply. The superior suprarenal gland from the phrenic artery, the middle suprarenal part from the aorta and the inferior suprarenal part. So that is supplied by renal artery. So when we arterial supply, the gland is divided into three parts, the superior and the middle and inferior. So this part is by phrenic artery, the middle part is by the aorta and from the inferior. Okay, like this. And the venous drainage, again it's a repetition we discussed in the difference. The right one is from the inferior vena cava and the left one is long and drain into left renal vein. Okay. The nerve supply is by parasympathetic fibers and also from the celiac plexus. Whereas the lymphatic drainage is by para-aortic lymph nodes. Shall we stop or shall we continue? We'll take a small break and then we'll continue. Okay? That is better. We'll do one thing.